Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We are talking about an-Nasakh, and we are saying that an-Nasakh can be proven both logically and from the text of the Sharia. And we need to know that there is no contradiction between sound logic and the text of the Sharia. Rather, if there appears to be a contradiction between the intellect and the text of the Sharia, then this is due to the fact that the person has deficient understanding or deficient knowledge. It is not because there is a genuine contradiction between the sound intellect and the text of the Sharia. Because the one who brought down the Sharia is also the one who created the intellect. So there is no contradiction between the creations of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Some people have said that an-Nasakh is not possible in the Sharia. They say this because if we say that Nasakh is possible, then it means that something new has occurred to Allah Jalla wa'ala which did not occur to him before. So first time round, Allah lays down a law, then afterwards Allah realizes that another law would be better, so he abrogated. And they say that this is not possible with Allah. Or they say that if we say Nasakh is permissible, then this means that Allah gained new knowledge which he did not know before. And so he laid down a ruling in accordance with his new knowledge. And so they say, of course, these things are not possible with Allah, therefore they say Nasakh is not possible. This is the well-known statement of the Yahud. As for the Yahud, then Allah Jalla wa'ala says about them, كُلُّ الطَّعَامِ كَانَ حِلًّا لِبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ إِلَّا مَا حَرَّمَ إِسْرَائِيلُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ. All of the food was halal for Bani Israel, except what Israel made haram upon himself. Israel is the name of Ya'qub alayhi salam. The food was halal for Bani Israel, but then afterwards Allah Jalla wa'ala made certain food types haram for them. And this is a type of nasakh, because takhsis is a type of nasakh. So here Allah Jalla wa'ala is making takhsis to the general rule. And the Yahud themselves say that the Sharia of Musa alayhi salam abrogates everything which came before it. So they are admitting that abrogation is possible. And this idea that if Nasakh is possible, then it means that Allah got to know about something which he did not know before, which is why he made the Nasakh, then we say no, this is not true. Because Nasakh is not based upon the knowledge of Allah Jalla wa'ala, rather it is based upon his hikmah. So the wisdom of Allah Jalla wa'ala dictates that for certain people at a certain time, such and such a ruling is best. Then when time moves on and people change, then the wisdom of Allah dictates that such and such a ruling is best for these people during this particular time. It does not necessitate that something new was learnt by Allah Jalla wa'ala. So for different times, places and people, different ruling apply in accordance with the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jal. So from here it becomes known that we can logically argue that Nasakh is possible in the Sharia, because first of all we ask, is Allah Jalla wa'ala the Rabb of the Alameen? Of course the answer is yes. This would necessitate therefore that the matter is in his hands. Ala lahu al-khalqu wal-amr. Verily the creation and the order belong to him. So he's the one who orders in his creation what he wants. And nobody will disagree with that. And so we can agree that if Allah Jalla wa'ala owns everything, then he can do in his creation as he wants to. And the sound intellect would not disagree with this fact. For example, if person A comes to the house of person B, and person B has a servant, and B tells his servant, go and bring a cup of coffee. So he gives him this order. Is it allowed for person A to tell person B, no, you cannot order your servant to bring a cup of coffee. How dare you order your servant in this way? Of course person A cannot say this, because the servant belongs to person B, and person B will order him as in how he wishes. So person B can easily turn around and say to person A, how can you come to my house and tell me that I am not allowed to order my servant to do what I want him to do? Who are you to tell me? Person B will say, I have more right to order my servant to do as I want than you have to come into my house, because the house belongs to me. So you cannot tell me to do anything. And this is a perfectly understandable example. So if this applies, then what about Allah Jalla wa'ala, who owns a bit more than just a house and a bit more than just one servant? He owns the heavens and the earth and all that which is in between, because he created it. Hence, he has the right to order whatever he wants to. So if that is understood, then let it also be understood that Allah Jalla wa'ala orders people with that which is in accordance with their benefits and their welfare. And this is what the wisdom of Allah Jalla wa'ala dictates, is that the rules of Allah are in accordance with the masalih, with the benefits or welfare of the people. So he will not order them to do anything which is harmful for them. This is why all the foodstuffs and drinks which you are not allowed to consume are harmful for you. Either they are purely harmful or they have more harm than benefit. And likewise with all the rules of the Sharia. If it is haram, then either it is purely harmful or its harms outweigh any benefits. And that which is wajib or halal is the other way around. But the point is that the laws of Allah are in accordance with what is beneficial for people, or their masalih. And we used this word when we were talking about al-maslahatul mursala earlier on in the presentation. And we know from the text that the laws of Allah are most beneficial for people, because Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Al-An'am, ayah 54, كَتَبَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ الرَّحْمَةِ. Your Lord has made obligatory upon him ar-rahmah, mercy. So the laws of Allah revolve around his mercy. Likewise, he says, وَمَا خَلَقْنَا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا لَاعِبِينَ. We have not created the heavens and the earth and all that which is in between them just out of play. No, rather there is a purpose in all of this creation, which is to order mankind and jinnkind to do specific things and to prohibit them from others. So he has created all of this creation as a test for mankind and jinnkind. Likewise, he says, أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَن يُتْرَكَ سُدًى. Does mankind think that they will be left without purpose? No, rather, they do have a purpose. And their purpose is to worship Allah, which means obeying His laws. So if these ayat are understood, then it will be understood that the wisdom of Allah dictates that He has to legislate and give laws for people to follow. So we've established that Allah has created this creation to pass down laws which must be followed and obeyed. And we've also established that the laws of Allah Jalla wa Ala are in accordance with the benefits of people. And this is out of His mercy, which Allah has obligated upon Himself. But now comes a crucial point. The benefits and welfare of the people differs from different people and different times. So if the benefits of people differ from different people and times and places, then so must the laws of Allah. So for example, in the beginning, Allah Jalla wa Ala gave the order, إِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ عِشْرُونَ صَابِرُونَ يَغْلِبُوا مِئَتَيْنَ. If there are 20 patient ones amongst you, you will overcome 200 from the kuffar. So the ratio is 1 to 10. And this is a big ratio and difficult for the Muslims. And then he lightened the load and he said, الْآنَ خَفَّفَ اللَّهُ عَنْكُمْ. Now Allah has lightened the load for you. وَعَلِمَ أَنَّ فِيكُمْ ضَعْفًا. And he knows that there is weakness in you. فَإِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ مِئَةٌ صَابِرَةٌ يَغْلِبُوا مِئَتَيْنِ وَإِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أَلْفٌ يَغْلِبُوا أَلْفَيْنِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. If there are 100 patient from you, you will overcome 200. And if there are 1,000 from you, you will overcome 2,000 by the permission of Allah. And Allah is with those who are patient. So now the ratio is 1 to 2. So it is from the rahmah of Allah Jalla wa Ala that He lightened the load. And He does this so that people can appreciate that Allah makes life easy and not difficult. And they could appreciate the rahmah. Because only when life is difficult and then becomes easy, do you truly appreciate the easiness. But if life is easy from the start, you will not appreciate it, you'll take it for granted. And so the rahmah and the hikmah of Allah Jalla wa Ala is in accordance with the benefits of mankind. But now somebody could ask a question, if it is true that the law of Allah changes with the changing benefits of the people, then clearly the 21st century is not the same as the 7th century. The people are different, times are different, and the places are different. But the law of Allah Jalla wa Ala came down in the 7th century. And we're talking about the Christian calendar. So people have different needs and benefits, therefore the law which came down back then does not apply now. We need new sets of laws to cater for the benefits of the people. So if we say that nasakh is permissible, then let this sharia, or at least parts of it, also be abrogated. We say no, this is not possible. And the reason why this is not possible is because up till yawm al-qiyamah, you will not find an issue except that the sharia has answers for it and has solutions for the problems. So when the Sharia was finalized and perfected, it was in accordance with what is beneficial for mankind up till Yawm al-Qiyamah. And this is the meaning of the ayah when Allah Jalla wa Ala says, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي. Today I have perfected or completed your deen for you and completed my favor upon you. So if something is perfected or completed, then is it possible for it to be improved? The answer is, of course, no, otherwise it wouldn't be perfect in the first place. So we say that the Sharia of Allah Jalla wa Ala is in accordance with the benefits of the people during all times and places up till Yawm al-Qiyamah. And the reason for this is because Allah has perfected the deen for us. And He did this over a period of 23 years. So there will not be any issue which arises at any time up till Yawm al-Qiyamah except that Islam will have the solution for it, or the answers to any questions which may arise. And this is part of the Sharia being perfected and completed. So that was the argument from the intellectual standpoint of view, that the sound intellect does understand that it is possible for there to be naskh in the Sharia, and that this is in fact completely in accordance with the wisdom of Allah Jalla wa Ala, and hence the benefits of the people. Now let us look at it from the text standpoint of view. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 106, مَا نَنْسَخْ مِنْ آيَةٍ أَوْ نُنْسِهَا نَأْتِ بِخَيْرٍ مِنْهَا أَوْ مِثْلِهَا. Whatever we abrogate from the ayah or make to forget, we will bring something better than it or like unto it. And so this is a zahir or apparent from the ayah, that Allah Jalla wa Ala can abrogate certain ayat or certain ahkam, but He will bring something which is either better or similar to it. Now somebody could still ask a question, if you bring something which is better, this is understandable, but why bother bring something similar? Isn't this just futile fun and play? We say, no, it is not. He could bring a ruling which is similar to the one which is abrogated, but it is similar from one perspective, but better from another perspective. For example, the Muslims would face Baytul Maqdis in their Salah, and this was at the beginning. Then this ruling was abrogated, and they had to face the Kaaba. Now from the standpoint of view of the slave, it doesn't actually matter where he faces, Baytul Maqdis or Kaaba. It doesn't matter, it's all the same thing. What matters to him is that is his Salah accepted with Allah Jalla wa Ala or not. Otherwise, where he faces is not very important. What is important is he praying and is his prayer sahih? So from this perspective, the abrogated ruling is similar to the ruling which is abrogating, meaning the second ruling. However, from another perspective, the second ruling is better because facing the Kaaba is better than facing Baytul Maqdis. Why is this? Because the Kaaba is more virtuous than Baytul Maqdis. It was the first masjid on earth and it has more virtue and sacredness than Baytul Maqdis. So therefore we find that if a ruling is replaced by a similar ruling, then it is not similar from all perspectives. It may be similar from one perspective, but the second ruling will always be better from a second perspective. Further evidence, Allah Jalla wa Ala saying about fighting the enemy, He goes, الْآنَ خَفَّفَ اللَّهُ عَنْكُمْ. Now Allah has lightened the load for you. Because previously the ratio was 1 Muslim to 10 kuffar, and then He lightened it to 1 Muslim to 2 kuffar. So if this is the ratio, then it is wajib upon the Muslims to fight. If the ratio exceeds this, so 1 Muslim to 3 kuffar, then the Muslims are allowed to flee, and it is not obligatory upon them to fight. Whereas previously they were not allowed to flee until the ratio was more than 1 to 10. And we have another example in the Psalm. In the beginning, the rule was that after you break your fast, if a person prayed Salatul Isha, then afterwards he was not allowed to eat, drink, or have intercourse. Or if he slept before Salatul Isha, then afterwards he was not allowed to eat, drink, or have intercourse with his wife. And this became difficult on the Muslims. So Allah Jalla wa Ala abrogated this law, and He says, فَالْآنَ بَاشِرُهُنَّ وَابْتَغُوا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. Now have intercourse with them and seek what Allah has written for you, meaning children, and eat and drink until the white thread of the Fajr becomes clear from the black thread, and then complete the Siyam up till the night, meaning Salatul Maghrib. We can give an example from the Sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ said in the Sahih, كُنْتُ نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ زِيَارَةِ الْقُبُورِ فَزُورُوهَا. I used to prohibit you from visiting the graves, but now visit them. So again, this is a naskh, from something being haram to something being mubah. So we can say that, speaking from a logical standpoint of view, and also from the text standpoint of view, we know that naskh occurs in the Sharia. But now we ask ourselves the question, can naskh occur in all the texts of the Sharia? The answer is no. There are certain types of texts in the Sharia in which nasakh cannot occur. And there are two types. Number one, when Allah Jalla wa'ala gives a piece of information and not a ruling. So a nasakh cannot occur when He gives you an information. This is because if there was a nasakh occurring in this way, it means that the first piece of information was wrong. And of course, it's not possible for Allah Jalla wa'ala to tell us something which is plainly and factually wrong. If, for example, you were told, Zayd came to the city. And then 1 minute later, the same person tells you, Zayd did not come to the city. So the second information is a nasakh. It abrogates the first information, which basically means the first information was factually incorrect. Whereas this is possible with humans and it happens all the time, it is not possible with Allah. Because Allah Jalla wa'ala does not say something which is factually incorrect. So when Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah Al-Fajr, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا, and your Lord will come with the angels in rows. Can Allah now turn to us and say, He will not come with the angels in rows? This is impossible, because it means that the first statement therefore was a lie. Or for example, He says, فَهَلْيَنْظُرُونَ إِلَّا السَّاعَةَ أَنْ تَأْتِيَهُمْ بَغْتَةً فَقَدْ جَاءَ أَشْرَاطُهَا. Are they waiting for except the final hour to come to them all of a sudden, and its signs have already come? So now can he say, its signs have not come? This piece of information, of course, can never be abrogated, because it would mean that the first piece of information was factually incorrect. So when it comes to certain facts and information in the Qur'an, that cannot be abrogated. And abrogation is specific for rulings and ahkam. Allah informs us that He sent Nuh to His people, and He sent Hud to the people of Ad, and He sent Salih to Thamud. Now can somebody say that there is a text in the Qur'an or Sunnah telling us that He sent the Prophet Hud to other than Ad, or Salih to other than Thamud? No, this is impossible. However, we need to note at this point that sometimes we could have a ruling given in the form of an information, so other than an order and a prohibition. An example of this we discussed before. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, إِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ عِشْرُونَ صَابِرُونَ يَغْلِبُوا مِئَتَيْنِ وَإِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ مِئَةٌ يَغْلِبُوا أَلْفًا مِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِأَنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ. If there are 20 patient amongst you, you will overcome 200. And if there are 100 amongst you, you will overcome 1,000 from those who disbelieve, because they are a people who do not understand. This is an information format. He does not say, you must fight 10 times your amount. Rather, he leaves it in an information format. But it carries the meaning of a hukum, a ruling, that you are not allowed to flee if they are 10 times more than you. So even though this is given in an information format, we know this is abrogated. Because even though it's in an information format, it carries the ruling of a hukum. Similarly, Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَالْمُطَلَّقَاتُ يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ ثَلَاثَةَ قُرُوءٍ. And divorced women stay in the waiting periods for 3 menstrual cycles. This is an information format, but it carries the meaning of a hukum, a ruling. So it's saying that the women who are divorced must wait for 3 menstrual cycles. Likewise, he says, وَالَّذِينَ يُتَوَفَّوْنَ مِنْكُمْ وَيَذَرُونَ أَزْوَاجًا يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ وَعَشْرًا. Those who die and leave behind wives from amongst you, then they will wait 4 months and 10 days. Again, information format, but it's giving a ruling that they must wait 4 months and 10 days. So if we have an information which carries the meaning of a ruling, then this is possible to be abrogated, because it is a ruling in this sentence which is intended. So that was the first type of text. The second type of text which cannot be abrogated are those texts which give rulings which are suitable for all times and places and are fundamentals of every deen. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا, and worship Allah and do not associate anyone with Him. This is clearly a ruling. Can it ever be said that this is abrogated or possible to be abrogated? Never. Because this is for all times and all places from the beginning of man up till Yawm al-Qiyamah. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدُونَ. And we did not send before you any messenger, except we inspired to him that there is no one worthy of worship except I, so worship me. So we find that this rule, which is the usul, the fundamentals, can never be abrogated. So we find it is not possible for tawheed to be abrogated. likewise with other rules, which are fit for all times and places, since the beginning of man till يوم القيامة. As Allah Jalla wa Ala says, قُلْ إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشَ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنْ وَالْإِثْمَ وَالْبَغْيَ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ وَأَنْ تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا وَأَنْ تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Say, my Lord has only made haram the immoral actions, what appear thereof and what are hidden, and committing sin and transgression without due right, and that you should associate with Allah what He has sent down no evidence for, and that you should speak against Allah what you do not know about. These types of laws can never ever be abrogated during any time and any place. Somebody might say, but is it not true that the Malaika were ordered to make sajda to Adam? And is this then not shirk? We say, no, it is not shirk. In fact, it is worship of Allah Jalla wa Ala, because Allah is the one who ordered them to prostrate to Adam. So if they had not prostrated to Adam, they would have been sinful. So what is haram and what is halal, what is shirk and what is not shirk, is completely in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal. In a similar way, we know that killing somebody without due right is haram, and it has always been haram in all of the religions and all of the shara'i. But especially to kill your own son should be even more haram, because now you're killing an innocent soul and you're also breaking ties of kinship. So there's two sins instead of one. However, Ibrahim alayhi salam was ordered to kill his only son Ismail, and he went ahead and was ready to kill him and to cut his throat with the knife. Normally this would be a repulsive action. However, in this case it was deemed worship of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Why? Because it was Allah who ordered him to do this. So whenever you obey the laws of Allah, you are in fact worshipping Him. And this is what the messengers came down with, to worship none but Allah Jalla wa Ala. And likewise, when it comes to the fundamental acts of worship, like the Salah, Zakah, Sawm and Hajj, then all of the nations before us were ordered with this. And so something like this can never be abrogated. For example, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was ordered, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي, and establish the prayer for my remembrance. Ismail alayhi salam, Allah Jalla wa Ala says about him, وَكَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ وَكَانَ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ مَرْضِيًّا. He used to order his family to perform the salah and give zakah, and he was one of those who was well pleased with his Lord. Meaning to say, Allah was well pleased with him. So this is evidence of salah and zakah being obligatory on the prophets and their nations before us. What about as-sawm? Allah Jalla wa Ala says, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Ordained for you is the siyam as it was ordained for those who were before you. Who before us? Everyone before us. Because the ayah is general. What about the hajj? Ibrahim alayhi salam was ordered, وَأَذِّمْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا, and make the adhan or proclaim to the people the hajj. They will come to you walking on feet and traveling on lean camels and so on. So all of these acts of worship were ordained for all of the nations before us. And so these fundamental acts of worship can never be abrogated. Yes, it's true to say that the detailed rulings about these acts of worship may have been different, but as for the asl of the act of worship itself, then this has never been abrogated. So all the five pillars of Islam that we have known were also pillars of the deen of those who were before us. And this was the message of all the prophets. So we find that the five pillars of Islam are nothing new to our Sharia. Also from the rulings which cannot be abrogated are rulings of noble character. So Allah orders us to be truthful, to be chaste, to be kind and to be courageous. All of these characteristics, in fact all religions teach these. But in any case, Islam encourages and orders these values and character in the human, and this can never be abrogated. As for bravery, then this falls under fighting in the way of Allah, and all prophets in the nations before us were ordered to fight in the way of Allah Jalla wa Ala. So jihad fi sabilillah in terms of fighting is nothing new to this Sharia. And hence this is also a ruling which can never be abrogated. Jihad fi sabilillah. Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, ayah 146 and 147, وَكَأَيِّن مِّن نَبِيٍّ قَاتَلَ مَعْهُ رِبِّيُّونَ كَثِيرٌ فَمَا وَهَنُوا لِمَا أَصَابَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَمَا ضَعُفُوا وَمَا اسْتَكَانُوا وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الصَّابِرِينَ. And how many a prophet fought in the way of Allah, and along with him fought large bands of religious learned men. but they never lost heart for what befell them in the way of Allah, nor did they weaken nor degrade themselves. And Allah loves those who are patient. وَمَا كَانَ قَوْلَهُمْ إِلَّا أَن قَالُوا رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَإِسْرَافَنَا فِي أَمْرِنَا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And they said nothing but, O our Lord, forgive our sins and our transgressions, establish our feet firmly, and grant us victory over the kuffar. So this was the statement of the prophets before us and their followers when they fought in the way of Allah. So fighting in the way of Allah is nothing new to this Sharia. Likewise, Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah At-Tawbah, in ayah number 111, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَيَقْتُلُونَ وَيُقْتَلُونَ وَعْدًا عَلَيْهِ حَقًّا فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ وَالْقُرْآنِ وَمَنْ أَوْفَى بِعَهْدِهِ مِنَ اللَّهِ فَاسْتَبْشِرُوا بِبَيْعِكُمُ الَّذِي بَايَعْتُمْ بِهِ وَذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ. Verily Allah has purchased of the believers their lives and their wealth, that in return theirs shall be Jannah. They fight in Allah's cause and they kill and are killed. It is a promise in truth which is binding on him, meaning Allah, in the Torah, Injil and the Qur'an. And who is truer to his covenant than Allah? Then rejoice in the bargain which you have concluded, that is the great success. So the shahid from the ayah is that he says that this is the promise of truth in the Torah and Injil and Qur'an. So we find in the previous scriptures, jihad fi sabilillah was legislated for all the prophets and their followers. So this type of ruling again cannot be abrogated. Yes, it's true that the detailed rulings within the act of worship may be different, but as for the asl of the worship, meaning the actual act itself, then no, it can never be abrogated. What about the prohibition of kufr? Could this ever be abrogated? Of course, the answer is no, because the prohibition on bad character can never be abrogated, and kufr is the worst of bad character, and of course the worst of sins. Likewise with other forms of bad character which is prohibited, lying, being evil, stingy, cowardice, and all these types of universally accepted bad character, the prohibition on this cannot be mansukh. At this point, let us ask ourselves a question. We talked about bravery. Is bravery always when you take a proactive action and embark upon something? The answer is no, not always. Sometimes bravery is when you don't do anything. Somebody may be hurling personal insults at you. Some people may think that if you react back and fight back, you're being brave. But actually, sometimes if you don't react, you're being brave, because it shows that you have self-control and self-discipline, and that you do not need to fight back in places where this is not warranted. Such as if somebody is throwing personal abuses at you, you do not take revenge because of personal reasons. Rather, you become angry and happy for the sake of Allah, not for your own sake. So in cases like these, the strong person is the one who controls himself at the time of anger. And it takes a brave person to do this, because it shows that you have control over yourself rather than your emotions having control over you. So we say that bravery is when you embark upon something, when that is warranted, and when you do not act or react in places where that is warranted. This is the balanced and correct way of looking at bravery. So these were the two types of texts which cannot be abrogated in the Sharia. Now let us move on to discussing the conditions for abrogation, shurut and nasakh. And there are two of these. So whenever somebody claims that a text of the Sharia has been made abrogated or is mansukh, then you need to ask yourself, have these two conditions been met or not? Before we discuss the conditions, we need to make it very clear that nasakh in the Sharia is potentially very dangerous. Why is this? Because what a nasakh necessitates is that we are discarding one of the evidences of the Sharia. And so basically we are not working with it. And this is a serious issue, because for us to discard any evidence of the Sharia needs some serious evidence. Because it is not for us to discard what Allah Jalla wa'ala has sent down upon us. Because the original ruling is that we are ordered to obey everything which Allah has sent down. So if we say that there is a nasakh, then we're saying that one of the evidences which Allah has revealed to us does not need to be followed. And this is a big statement, and it can never be taken lightly. Therefore, if we said there is a nasakh in the sharia, it must fulfill two conditions. The first condition is, between the two evidences, you cannot make any reconciliation. So there appears to be a direct contradiction between the two evidences. So whenever you can make a reconciliation, it is not permissible to make a claim of a nasakh. So we find many ulama saying that those ayat in the Qur'an which speak about forgiving the kuffar and overlooking them as they harm the Muslims, this is abrogated with all those ayat which talk about fighting the kuffar. This is not true. So for example, Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Al-Jathiyah, Ayah 14, قُلْ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَغْفِرُوا لِلَّذِينَ لَا يَرْجُونَ أَيَّامَ اللَّهِ لِيَجْزِيَ قَوْمًا بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. Say, O Prophet, to those who believe, that they should forgive those who do not hope in the days of Allah, in order that Allah may reward a people in accordance with what they have earned. So here this ayah is telling the Muslims to forgive the kuffar, as the kuffar were obviously annoying the Muslims and harming them. So many scholars have said that this ayah is abrogated, in terms of its ruling, by all those ayat which speak of jihad. And this is not true. The reason why this is not true is because we can make a reconciliation between the ayat which talk about forgiving the kuffar and those which talk about fighting them. What's the reconciliation? It is simple. We say that in those times when Muslims are weak, perhaps they do not have a ruler and an army, then in these times they are ordered to forgive the kuffar, because it's not like they can fight. And when the Muslims are powerful, they have a ruler and they have an army, and they are in a position of power, then in these times they are allowed to fight back. So if we make this reconciliation, then we find that there is no abrogation. Likewise, many ulama have claimed that the story of Salim, the freed slave of Abu Hudhayfa, is abrogated. The story is that the wife of Abu Hudhayfa came to the Prophet complaining that their servant boy, Salim, had reached puberty. And of course the servant would be in the house with the wife of Abu Hudhayfa. And so Abu Hudhayfa did not like that Salim should be alone with his wife, because Salim had reached adulthood. And of course he would have his desires for women just like normal men. And this took its toll on Abu Hudhayfa. So the wife of Abu Hudhayfa came to ask the Prophet about this issue. And the Prophet said to her, give Salim some of your breast milk, so that he will become a son through breastfeeding to you. And so he would become your mahram in this case. Many ulama say that this is abrogated because the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا الرَّضَاعَةُ مِنَ الْمَجَاعَةِ, that الرَّضَاعَة, breastfeeding, is only from hunger. Meaning to say, when the baby is young and it is feeding on breast milk, then this is the time when you have to breastfeed, and this is the time when the mahramiya becomes established. So they say that the breastfeeding which makes you into a mahram is that which takes place in the first 2 years of the life of the baby, because this is the time when the baby is breastfeeding. But of course in the story of Salim, he had reached adulthood, and certainly he was not within the first 2 years. So the question is this really a nasakh or not? The answer is no, this is not a nasakh, because we are able to reconcile between the two evidences. And the reconciliation is simply this, that if anybody finds themselves in a situation similar to what Abu Hudhayfa found himself in, so he has a wife and he also has a servant, and the servant reaches adulthood, then in this case his wife can give the servant breast milk, and the servant will become a mahram to the wife. So now the servant can be in privacy with the wife. Otherwise, in any other normal cases, breastfeeding is only in the first 2 years, and the mahramiyah only becomes established at that time. So like this, we make a reconciliation between the evidences, and we can work with both the evidences. And this is far better than saying nasakh, because when you use nasakh, then it means that you have to discard the ruling of one of the evidences. And this is not a light matter when it comes to the sharia of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Similarly, Allah Jalla wa Ala says to the Prophet in the Qur'an, إِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Verily you are guiding to the straight path. But in another place he says, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ. You cannot guide whom you love. There appears to be a contradiction. And so some people may claim that the first ayah is abrogated. But is it really abrogated? Meaning to say, is it not possible for us to make a reconciliation? The answer is, yes, it's possible. And the reconciliation is simply this, that guidance, hidayah, is of two types. Hidayatul irshad and hidayat al-tawfiq. Hidayat al-Irshad is when you simply point out the right path to somebody. As for Hidayat al-Tawfiq, it is actually putting somebody on the right path. So there's a difference between pointing out the right path and actually putting him on the right path. The Prophet, and likewise all of us, can give everybody else a Hidayat al-Irshad, point out the right path to them. But can we actually put them on the right path? No, this guidance belongs to Allah Jalla wa Ala alone. So Hidayat al-Tawfiq belongs to Allah alone. So in the second ayah, it is talking about Hidayat al-Tawfiq. In the first ayah, it is talking about Hidayat al-Irshad. Simple reconciliation. And no need to claim Nasr. But another reason why we know that it is not possible for there to be a Nasr between these two ayat is because, as we mentioned before, when it comes to al-ikhbar, information, then there can be no nasr in the information items which are given in the Qur'an. Nasr only applies to rulings, and we gave the exceptions to this. And when we look at these two ayat, they are giving information. One is saying you are guiding to the right path, and the other one is saying you do not guide whomsoever you love. This is not a ruling, this is an information. Therefore there can be no nasr. Because if we say that there is a nasr, then it means that one of these information items is false. So Allah Jalla wa Ala has told us something which is factually incorrect. And this can never be the case. So always bear in mind that whenever somebody talks about a nasr in the Qur'an or the ahadith, then you need to ask yourself, is it an information item which has been given, or is it a ruling? And you need to know about the types of text, and there are two of them, in which nasr can never occur. So anyway, that was the first condition. Now the second condition is that we know the dates between the two evidences. Because a nasr can only happen when we know that the second evidence came after the first evidence. So when we try to reconcile between the two evidences, and we cannot reconcile, and there is a genuine contradiction, then we need to look at the dates. If we know the dates, then a nasr is possible. So this way we know that the later evidence is abrogating the earlier evidence. How do we know the dates? Sometimes we can know about the dates from the text of the evidences themselves, or sometimes a Sahabi could inform us of the dates, or he could say something from which we can deduce the dates, or sometimes we can know this through the history. An example of the first, where we find evidence of the dates, in the text itself, the hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ said, كُنْتُ أَذِنْتُ لَكُمْ فِي الْإِسْتِمْتَاعِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ حَرَّمَ ذَلِكَ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. I used to permit the marriage of Mut'a, but now Allah has made it haram up till يوم القيامة. The marriage of Mut'a is when you marry somebody for a limited time period which you fix. This used to be halal, but then it became abrogated and is now haram up till يوم القيامة. But the Shia are well known for carrying on this practice. So here we know that this is abrogated, and we know about the date because the date is in the text itself. He says, I used to permit this, but now it is haram till yawm al-qiyamah. So we know this is an abrogation. And in a similar example, the hadith in the Sahih, كُنْتُ نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ زِيَارَةِ الْقُبُورِ فَزُورُوهَا. I used to prohibit you from visiting the graves, but now visit them. Again, this is a nasr. And as for the date, we know it from the text itself. As for the second type, the statement of a sahabi, then the example is in Sahih Muslim, the statement of Aisha radiallahu anha, when she says that, in the first instance, 10 sucklings would create the mahramiyya. And then this was abrogated to 5 sucklings when the Prophet ﷺ died. So we find that now 5 sucklings of breastfeeding makes the child into the mahram of the woman. So this is a statement of a sahabi, which tells us about an abrogation. And then the third method, when we follow the text and try to deduce the chronological order. An example of this in the Qur'an, about the ratio of Muslims to kafir in the battlefield. It used to be 1 to 10, and then was abrogated to 1 to 2. How do we know this is an abrogation? Because we find in the text, he says, الْآنَ خَفَّفَ اللَّهُ عَنْكُمْ. Now Allah has lightened the load for you. So the word الْآن, meaning now, indicates that this ayah is coming after the previous ayah, which talks about the ratio of 1 to 10. So we find that when we follow the text, it could give us clues as to which ruling came after which ruling. So these are two conditions for nasr to be possible. Most scholars add a third condition, and they say that the text which is nasikh, abrogating, needs to be either as authentic or more authentic than the text which is mansukh or abrogated. So according to them, they say that a hadith which is ahad cannot abrogate a hadith or an ayah which is mutawatir. Because of course we know that mutawatir is of a higher authenticity than a hadith which is ahad. However, the correct opinion is that this is not a valid condition, and that as long as both the nasikh and mansukh are authentic, then an abrogation can take place. And we do not consider the level of authenticity of the evidences. Rather, what this idea of nasq revolves around is the actual hukum itself, the ruling itself, not the level of authenticity of the ruling. As long as both the nasikh and mansukh are authentic, then a nasq takes place, because it's the ruling which we need to focus on, not the degree of authenticity. Of course, this does not mean to say that a da'if hadith can abrogate anything. Of course, a da'if hadith does not have a role to play in the sharia, and its presence is like its absence, and we do not give it any consideration. However, as long as a hadith is authentic, then it can abrogate the ruling from a hadith which is even more authentic. And this is a correct opinion, even if it is the minority opinion. So upon this, it is possible for a hadith which is graded to be hasan, say, to abrogate a ruling from the Qur'an. And of course all the ayat of the Qur'an are mutawatir. Now let us move on to divisions of nasakh. From the perspective of the text which is abrogated, meaning the mansukh, we can divide a nasakh up into three categories. Category number one, when the ruling is abrogated, but the text of the ruling remains. And this happens frequently in the Qur'an. And the example of this is, as we have quoted before, he says, إِن يَكُم مِنْكُمْ عِشْرُونَ صَابِرُونَ يَغْلِبُوا مِئَتَيْنِ وَإِن يَكُم مِنْكُمْ مِئَةٌ يَغْلِبُوا أَلْفًا مِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. If there are 20 patients amongst you, you will overcome 200. And if there are 100, you will overcome 1,000 from those who have disbelieved, meaning the kuffar. So the ratio is 1 to 10. Then he goes on to say, الآن خفف الله عنكم. Now Allah has lightened the load for you. وَعَلِمَ أَنَّ فِيكُمْ ضَعْفًا. And he knows that there is weakness in you. فَإِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ مِئَةٌ صَابِرَةٌ يَغْلِبُوا مِئَتَيْنِ وَإِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أَلْفٌ يَغْلِبُوا أَلْفَيْنِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. If there are 100 patients amongst you, you will overcome 200. And if there are 1,000, then you will overcome 2,000 with the permission of Allah, and Allah is with the صابرين. So now the ratio is 1 to 2. But the point is that the ayah which is abrogated, its wordings remain in the Qur'an, but the ruling is abrogated. Now we ask ourselves, why is this the case? Meaning the words remain but the ruling doesn't? Two reasons. First of all, if the words remain, then these words will be recited. And when you recite the words of the Qur'an, you are rewarded for them. So it increases us in the reward, if the words remain. The second reason is, we can know the wisdom behind the nasakh. And that in this case, it is Allah Jalla wa'ala lightening the load. Because if the words did not remain, then we would not know the wisdom behind the nasakh. The second category is the opposite of the first, where the ruling remains, but the wording is abrogated. So we do not find the wording anymore. An example of this is the ayah of Rajm, which came down in the Qur'an. This is when you stone the adulterer to death. This was revealed in the Qur'an, but now you do not find it anymore. But the ruling remains. And the evidence for this is a statement of Umar radiallahu anhu in Sahih al-Bukhari, when he says that the ayah of Rajm came down in the Qur'an, and the Prophet carried it out, and we carried it out afterwards, but then the wordings were abrogated. And he says that, I fear that somebody would come after a long time, and he will say that we do not find any evidence of Rajm in the Qur'an, and they will leave off something which Allah has made obligatory. And Rajm is obligatory for every person who has had intercourse in a valid nikah contract, and then he commits zina, or if there is a pregnancy, or if there is a confession. And this is how he said it. So a Rajm is done to the one who is muhsin, the one who has had intercourse in a valid nikah contract whilst he was baligh, aqil, and hur, meaning free and not a slave. And the reason why such a horrid looking punishment is ordained by Allah Jalla wa'ala is because when people see another person getting stoned, the sound human intellect would naturally feel repulsed from committing zina. And so the idea behind these punishments in the sharia is to prevent the sin from taking place in the first place. And it is only out of justice that you give a horrid punishment for a horrid sin. But actually, this punishment is a mercy for the one being stoned to death. And this is that if he takes his punishment in this life, he will not need to take it in the hereafter. And Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَلَعَذَابُ الْآخِرَةِ أَكْبَرُ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. And the punishment of the hereafter is bigger or greater if only they had known. So if you take your punishment in this world, it will be a kafara and you will not need to face it in the hereafter. So actually it is a mercy on the one who is taking the punishment. And we find that what Umar radiallahu anhu warned about is taking place in this day and age. That people, even amongst the Muslims, you would find rejecting this idea of stoning the adulterer to death. They would say that if the person, the man and the woman, commit zina out of their own consent, then what can be wrong with this? It's not like anybody was forced to do what they wanted to. So in making statements of this nature, they actually want to reduce humans to a beast level, just like animals. Because it is animals who can have intercourse with each other as and how they wish, because animals do not have knowledge of the family tree such that they would know who their forefathers are. And even amongst the kuffar countries, people know who their fathers are and their forefathers and so on. They have the family tree. The whole point about zina is that it ruptures and destroys the family tree, and it destroys families. This is one of the essential differences between humans and beasts, that humans have a preserved bloodline, or at least they ought to, so that you know who your mother is and who your father is. And zina seeks to destroy this. And one of the five daruriyat of Islam, which is something we spoke about earlier on in the presentation, is to preserve the bloodline, the ansab. So if we allow a person to have sex with whomsoever he wants, whenever he wants, however he wants, wherever he wants, then actually humans have become worse than even beasts. Because beasts are not mukallaf. Allah Jalla wa Ala has not burdened them with certain obligations. And they don't have intellects. Humans do, and they are burdened with certain obligations. And they will be questioned about this. So if now humans start acting like beasts when they have intellects, then actually humans are becoming worse than beasts. Because animals act the way they do because they work on instinct, not intellect. But if humans now start behaving like beasts when they have intellect, then actually you're lowering yourself to even lower than beasts. It's like a dog barks. It barks because this is what dogs do. And nobody is going to blame a dog for barking. But if a human goes down on his knees and hands and starts barking the same way as a dog, then we say that this human acting like a dog is even worse than the dog, because he ought not to be acting like this because a human has intellect. And Umar radiallahu anhu in the narration informs us that the rajam is from the farida, from the fard elements which Allah Jalla wa Ala has sent down. And if the case is taken to court and it is proven to be authentic, so we have the witnesses, then the had punishment is obligatory to be applied. And the Prophet ﷺ said to Usama ibn Zayd, when he was trying to intercede from the woman from Al-Makhzum, who was found guilty of borrowing things from people and then denying that she borrowed it. So she had to have her hands cut off. And so he interceded on behalf of her because she was a person of status, and the Quraysh did not want her hand to be cut off. And the Prophet ﷺ said, أَتَشْفَعُ فِي حَدٍ مِّنْ حُدُودِ اللَّهِ. Are you interceding in one of the had punishments of Allah? إِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ أَنَّهُمْ إِذَا سَرَقَ فِيهِمْ الْغَنِي تَرَكُوا وَإِذَا سَرَقَ فِيهِمْ الضَّعِيفِ أَقَامُوا عَلَيْهِ الْحَدِ. The only thing which destroyed those who were before you is that when a rich person stole, they would leave him, and when a poor person stole, they would establish the had punishment on him. وَيْمُ اللَّهِ لَوْ أَنَّ فَاطِمَةَ بِنْتَ مُحَمَّدْ سَرَقَتْ لَقَطَعْتُ يَدَهَا. Wallahi, if Fatima, daughter of Muhammad, stole, I would cut off her hand. So this is how important the had punishment is. That even if the best of women, Fatima, was to steal, then she would have to taste the had punishment. But the point from the narration of Umar is that he says that the ayah was revealed in the Quran, they recited it and they understood it. So now where is this ayah? We say its wording has been abrogated, but the ruling remains. It has been said by many people that the ayah which has been abrogated is الشَّيْخُ وَالشَّيْخَةُ إِذَا زَنَيَا فَرْجُمُوهُمَا أَلْبَتَّةَ نَكَالًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. That the old man and the old women, if they commit fornication, then stone them as an exemplary punishment from Allah. and Allah is the Aziz Hakim. But this ayah does not agree with what is authentically known from the Sunnah. From the Sunnah is, the person you stone is the one who has had sexual intercourse in a valid nikah contract whilst he was baligh, aqil and hur, meaning free. But as for this ayah, it is saying that the old person, man or woman, you stone them. So this means that if the old person has not had intercourse in a valid marriage contract, which is the nikah contract, then they are to be stoned. And this is simply not true. Likewise, if a young person who is a thayyib, meaning he has had intercourse in a valid nikah contract, and he then commits zina, then he is not to be stoned because he is not a shaykh, he is not an old person. So either way, it does not hold true. So we do not rely upon this narration that this is the ayah which has been abrogated. And even if somebody says that the chain of narration which is informing us that this is the ayah which is abrogated, even if this chain is authentic, we can still say that the narration is shadh. Now one asks a question, what is the wisdom in Allah abrogating the wording but making the ruling remain? The answer is to test this ummah that the words you don't even find in the Qur'an but the ruling remains, so will you act in accordance with the ruling or not? So it is basically a test. And also this shows that this ummah is completely different to the ummah of the Yahud, because with the Yahud they found the text of rajm, stoning, in their book, but still they tried to cover it up and find ways around this ruling. Because amongst the nobility of the Yahud, zina became widespread. And they couldn't punish the nobility in this way. So they had to find a ring road around this ruling. So what they would do, they substituted it with another punishment. They blackened the faces of the people committing fornication, and they put them on a donkey and publicly humiliated them, and people would make tawaf around this donkey, and they would be known to be fornicators. And then after that, they would go home and clean them back up again, and everything would be back to normal. But they would not stone them to death, even though they found the evidence from the text in their Tawrah. And the story is well known. When the Prophet made hijrah to Al-Madinah, there was a case where a man and a woman from the Yahud committed zina, and they came to the Prophet asking him what the punishment should be. They were hoping that the Prophet would give them an alternative to a rajm. However, the Prophet said, what do you find in your Tawrah? So they brought along the Tawrah, and one of the reciters, he covered the ayah of rajm up with his hand. But Abdullah ibn Salam, who was one of the scholars of the Yahud and he converted to Islam, he told the man, take your hand off. And when he took the hand off, they found the ayah of rajm. And so the Prophet ordered that the man and the woman be stoned to death. So we find that the ummah of the Yahud were different. Even though they found the text, still they wanted to find some ring road around the ruling. So this ummah, Allah Jalla wa'ala is testing it, that you don't find the wordings in the Qur'an, but will you still act in accordance with the law of Allah Jalla wa'ala or not? And so if this ummah acts in accordance with the law of Allah, then it shows that this ummah is better than the ummah of the Yahud. Then we have the third category, when both the wording and the ruling have been abrogated. An example of this is the statement of Aisha in Sahih Muslim, when she says that, in the first instance, 10 sucklings would make the mahramiya, and this was revealed in the Quran. Then it was abrogated to 5 sucklings, and this is what was recited in the Quran when the Prophet ﷺ died. So the wordings of the 10 sucklings are not to be found in the Quran, and also the ruling is not to be found in the Sharia anymore because it has been abrogated. So both the wordings and the ruling have been abrogated. But at this point, somebody may ask us some questions. Firstly, they would say that this narration is in Sahih Muslim and not in Sahih al-Bukhari. So would this not detract from the authenticity of this narration? Secondly, they would ask, everything in the Qur'an is mutawatir. And for it to be abrogated, then the majority of the scholars say that it can only be abrogated with something else which is mutawatir. And we spoke about this, that this is the majority viewpoint, even though it is not the correct viewpoint. But according to the majority, only mutawatir can abrogate mutawatir. But what we have here is just a statement of Aisha radiallahu anha, and this is certainly not at a mutawatir level. And thirdly, they would ask that if it was abrogated to 5 sucklings, and she says that this is what was recited in the Qur'an, but the point is, we don't see this recited in the Qur'an. Where is it in the Qur'an that 5 sucklings make the mahramiyyah? So let's take a look at these points. Point number one, that it is only found in Sahih Muslim and not Al-Bukhari. This should not even be an issue, because there are many ahadith which are only found in Muslim and not in Al-Bukhari. It doesn't mean that they are not authentic. So any hadith which is found in Muslim and not in Al-Bukhari doesn't mean that it is not authentic, but rather it can be relied upon. As for the second issue, that you need something mutawatir to abrogate another mutawatir, even if we say that this is true, which it is not, but for argument's sake, we'll go along with the majority opinion. But the point is that in the narration, Aisha radiallahu anha is informing us of both the nasikh and the mansukh. The nasikh being the 5 sucklings and the mansukh being the 10 sucklings. So actually in the narration itself, both the nasikh and mansukh are of equal strength and authenticity, because Aisha is informing us of both of them. So she's actually saying that the nasikh was mutawatir and the mansukh was mutawatir. So we find that they are both of equal strength. Hence we do have a situation of a mutawatir abrogating another mutawatir. The third point, why do we not find the ayah of 5 sucklings in the Qur'an? The reason is because the wordings of the 5 sucklings have been abrogated, but the ruling remains. But we know still that it is not possible for anything to be abrogated after the death of the Prophet ﷺ. This is true, but the wordings of the 5 sucklings were abrogated before the death of the Prophet. But this does not mean that everybody was aware of the fact that the wordings of the 5 sucklings have been abrogated. So when the Prophet died, these wordings of the 5 sucklings were being recited in the Qur'an by people who are not aware that the wordings of the 5 sucklings have been abrogated. And it must have been the case that after the death of the Prophet and after some time went by, everyone became aware that the wordings are abrogated. And now we ask ourselves the same question: what is the hikmah or the wisdom behind abrogating the wording and the ruling? The wisdom is so that people can know that the Sharia was developed stage by stage. So in this case, we know that in the first instance, it was 10 sucklings, then it was abrogated to 5 sucklings. So this is a development, stage by stage. So these were the category of an-naskh with regards to the ruling and the wordings. We can also categorize an-naskh with regards to which text is abrogating which text. And there are 4 categories here. Category number 1, when the Qur'an abrogates another part of the Qur'an. And there's no difference of opinion amongst the scholars that this is possible, and indeed we can find examples. We have already given the ayah of Al-Musabara, when the Muslims are ordered to be more patient than the Kuffar, and the ratio in the beginning was 1 Muslim to fight 10 Kuffar, and reduced to 1 Muslim to 2 Kuffar. And this is ayah 65 in Surah Al-Anfal. Likewise, we gave the example with the As-Siyam, that if a person prayed his Salat Al-Isha, then he had to make the Siyam up until the Maghrib the next day. Or if he went to sleep, then he had to make the Saum up until Maghrib the next day. And this was difficult for the Muslims. So Allah Jalla wa Ala revealed in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 187, فَالْآنَ بَاشِرُوهُنَّ وَابْتَغُوا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. And now have intercourse with them and seek what Allah has written for you, meaning children, and eat and drink until the white thread of Fajr becomes clear from the black thread, meaning the black thread of night, and then complete your Siyam up till the night. So this was a clear lightening of the load, and is an example of the Qur'an abrogating the Qur'an. And the key word is فَالْآنَ, so now. So this shows us that the ruling is being changed. Then the second category is when the Qur'an is abrogated by the Sunnah. As for examples, there don't appear to be any valid examples which we could use. However, some examples have been suggested, but there is a problem with them. So let's take a look. They say that Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 180, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذَا حَضَرَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتُ إِنْ تَرَكَ خَيْرًا الْوَصِيَّةُ لِلْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ حَقًّا عَلَى الْمُتَّقِينَ. It is prescribed for you, when death approaches any one of you, if he leaves wealth, then he makes a wasiyah, a bequest, to the parents or his close relatives, according to a reasonable manner. This is a duty on all those who have taqwa. They say that this ayah has been abrogated by the hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَعْطَى كُلَّ ذِي حَقٍّ حَقَّهُ فَلَا وَصِيَّةٍ لِوَارِثٍ. Allah has given everyone who has a due right their right, so there can be no wasiyah or a bequest for an inheritor. However, if we ponder over this, we find that there is no nasq whatsoever. Rather, this is a takhsis. And a takhsis is when you make a nasq to certain elements of the generality. As for the ayah, it mentions al-walidain and al-aqrabin, the parents and the near relatives. We know that your parents inherit from you in accordance with the fixed shares of the Qur'an. As for the aqrabin, the near relatives, then from them are those who inherit and from them are those who do not inherit. But the hadith talks about that there cannot be any wasiyah or bequest to your inheritors. But it doesn't talk about your relatives who will not inherit from you. Therefore, for them, there can be a bequest. So therefore, the ayah does still hold true, that if death approaches one of you, you are to leave a bequest for your near relatives. So from your near relatives will be those who will not inherit from you. For example, your children from your son will not inherit, because your son is going to inherit from you. So he will block off anyone who is lower than him in the family line. Which basically means you are allowed to leave a bequest to those grandchildren of yours, meaning the children of your son. Likewise, the children of your daughter, they do not inherit from you, but you can leave a bequest for them, if need be. So the ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah still holds true about the wasiyah, about the bequest. But the hadith simply makes an exception to the general case, which is to say that those people who have fixed inheritance assigned, there is no wasiyah for them. Because Allah Jalla wa'ala has dictated what they are going to receive. So it's not like you need to give them a wasiyah. Another example they give, the ayah number 15 from Surah An-Nisa, وَالَّاتِ يَأْتِينَ الْفَاحِشَةَ مِن نِسَائِكُمْ فَاسْتَشْهِدُوا عَلَيْهِنَّ أَرْبَعَةً مِنْكُمْ فَإِنْ شَهِدُوا فَأَمْسِكُوهُنَّ فِي الْبُيُوتِ حَتَّى يَتَوَفَّاهُنَّ الْمَوْتُ أَوْ يَجَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَهُنَّ سَبِيلًا. And as for those women who fornicate, then bring forth four witnesses against them. So if these witnesses testify against them, then keep these women back in the house until death overtakes them, meaning until they die, or until Allah makes for them a way out. They say that this ayah has been abrogated by the hadith in the Sahih, when the Prophet ﷺ said, خُذُوا عَنِّي خُذُوا عَنِّي قَدْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَهُنَّ سَبِيلًا الْبِكْرُ بِالْبِكْرِ جِلْدُ مِئَةٍ وَتَغْرِيبُ عَامٍ وَالثَّيِّبُ بِالثَّيِّبِ جِلْدُ مِئَةٍ وَالرَّجُمُ. Take from me, take from me, Allah has made for them a way. A virgin with a virgin, they are to be given 100 lashes and exiled from the land for a year. And as for a thayyib, then they are to be given 100 lashes and stoned. So they say that these women do not need to be kept back in the home until death approaches them, rather they are to be given this had punishment. But upon pondering, we find that this is not an abrogation, because Allah Jalla wa'ala says in the ayah, hold them back in the houses until they die or until Allah makes for them a way out. And in the hadith, he just explains this, that Allah has made for them a way out. So nothing of the ayah has been abrogated. So the ayah in fact has not been abrogated, because the ayah itself says, until Allah makes for them a way out. So we are in fact obeying the ayah, because Allah has made for them a way out, which is explained in the hadith. So the ayah is not abrogated, but rather we are working in accordance with it. So as it happens, we do not seem to find a valid example. And coming under this category is the difference of opinion, as we mentioned before. Most scholars say that only something of a mutawatir level can abrogate an ayah of the Qur'an, because an ayah of the Qur'an is of course mutawatir. So upon this, only a mutawatir hadith could abrogate an ayah of the Qur'an. But the correct opinion is, anything authentic can abrogate anything authentic. Then we have the third category, that the Qur'an abrogating a sunnah. An example of this, when the Prophet made hijrah to Al-Madinah, then for about 16 or 17 months, he was performing the salah facing Baytul Maqdis. But he would love for the Qibla to be changed to the Kaaba. So we find in the sunnah, you are facing the Baytul Maqdis, but then this was abrogated by the ayah in the Qur'an, in Surah Al-Baqarah, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. We have seen you turning your face to the sky or upwards, so we will surely turn you to a qibla, to a direction which will please you, so turn your face towards the Masjid al-Haram. And this is because the Prophet would look up towards the sky, hoping that there would be some revelation coming down, changing the qibla. Somebody might say that this is actually the Qur'an abrogating the Qur'an, because Allah Jalla wa'ala says in the Qur'an, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَى اللَّهِ فَبِهُدَاهُ مُقْتَدِهِ. Those are the ones that Allah guided, so follow their guidance. And this is when he was talking about the previous prophets. And they say that the previous prophets were facing the Baytul Maqdis. So Allah has ordered the Prophet to follow their guidance. And from their guidance is to face Baytul Maqdis during the prayer. But Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says, the Qibla of all the Prophets before us was the Masjid al-Haram. As Allah Jalla wa'ala says, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ وُضِعَ لِلنَّاسِ لَلَّذِي بِبَكَّةَ مُبَارَكًا. The first house put for mankind was the one in Mecca, and the word uses Bakka, blessed house. This was the direction of all the Prophets in their prayer, Masjid al-Haram. But they say it was turned to Bayt al-Maqdis because the Jews and the Christians changed the text of their books. Otherwise, the Prophets would face Masjid al-Haram. So for those people to use the example in which Allah orders the Prophet to take the guidance of the Prophets before, then this is not correct, because the guidance of the Prophet before was that they turned to Masjid al-Haram in their salah. Then we have the fourth category, the sunnah abrogating a sunnah. And we have given examples before, the Prophet saying that he used to forbid the people from visiting the grave, so now visit them. Likewise he said, كُنْتُ نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنِ النَّبِيذ فِي الْأَوْعِيَةِ فَاشْرَبُوا فِي مَا شِئْتُمْ وَلَا تَشْرَبُوا مُسْكِرًا. I used to forbid you from making nabith, which is a drink made out of grapes or dates. And he used to forbid this for them to make this drink in the containers. So now he says, so drink whatever you want and from wherever you want, but do not drink the intoxicant. This is because the nabith would turn into an intoxicant if it is left there for a few days. So as long as you drink the nabith when it is not intoxicating, this is fine. But you're not allowed to drink anything which intoxicates. And we also know from the Sahih that the Prophet ordered the delegation of Abdul Qais not to use the Muzaffat, Hantam, Naqir and Al-Muqayyar. These are all pots in which Nabith was made. And he ordered them this out of fear that people will start to use these pots to make intoxicants. But afterwards, this was abrogated and you were allowed to use any container you want, but it's just that you were not allowed to drink intoxicants. So the matter was strict first time round, so that the people become used to not drinking the intoxicants. Now let's move on to talking about the wisdoms of An-Nasr. Because people might criticize An-Nasr, how can the Sharia of Allah have anything abrogated? But there are wisdoms behind it, and everything which Allah does has hikmah behind it. Sometimes we know it and sometimes we don't. So let's talk about the hikam of An-Nasr. We already stated before that the ruling of Allah is based on His wisdom, and the wisdom of Allah is based on what is most beneficial for His creation. But from time to time and place to place, what is most beneficial can change. Hence the wisdom of Allah dictates that the laws must be subject to change. And every Prophet was sent to his people with a Sharia which abrogated the Sharia which was before it. So the Sharia of Isa alayhi salam abrogated the Sharia of Musa alayhi salam, because he came afterwards. Likewise, the Sharia of Muhammad والسلام, abrogates all of the Shara'i before. So the first wisdom behind An-Nasr, we say, is that Allah Jalla wa'ala is concerned with the benefits of the people. And so He will change the ruling in accordance with what is most beneficial for them. The second benefit is that it explains to us that the Sharia has been developed stage by stage. So when you see this development process, then you can appreciate that the Sharia is complete and perfect. So for example, the first time round, they had to pray 2 rak'at in the Salah. Then when the Prophet ﷺ made the Hijrah, then the Salah in the city, meaning when you're a resident, it was increased to 4 rak'at. And of course Maghrib was 3, and Salat al-Fajr remained the same. And as for the prayer in the travel, then it remained at 2 rak'at. So again, this is a developmental process, stage by stage. And also we have the example of the Khamr. It was permissible during the early days. Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah An-Nahl, وَمِن ثَمَرَاتِ النَّخِيلِ وَالْأَعْنَابِ تَتَّخِذُونَ مِنْهُ سَكَرًا وَرِزْقًا حَسَنًا إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَعْقِلُونَ. And from the fruits of the date and the grapes, you derive from it an intoxicant and a goodly provision. Truly in that are signs for those who understand. So this ayah is clearly stating that the intoxicant is permissible, and that this is one of the provisions which Allah has given you. Then the first stage of prohibition came, and this was the lighter prohibition, just preparing them to accept the final ruling. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ. They ask you about the khamr and the maysir, gambling. قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِن نَفْعِهِمَا. Say, in them there is a big sin, but also benefits for people, but their sin is bigger than their benefit. So up to now, the intelligent person will leave off gambling and khamr, because their sin is greater than the benefit, but it has not been officially made haram. Then the second stage, which is making it haram on certain occasions. In Surah An-Nisa, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقَرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُولُونَ. Oh, you believe, do not approach the salah whilst you are intoxicated until you know what you are saying. So now this means that at least 5 times a day you're not allowed to be intoxicated, but you can be intoxicated in between. So the screw is gradually being tightened. And then the third stage in the prohibition, Surah Al-Ma'idah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنْصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Oh, you believe, khamr and maysir and ansab, which is when you sacrifice for the idols, and azlam, which is when you seek a decision by shooting arrows, this is all impurity from the works of shaitan, so avoid it so that you may be successful. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَن يُوقِعَ بَيْنَكُمُ الْعَدَاوَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءَ فِي الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ وَيَصُدَّكُمْ عَن ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَعَنِ الصَّلَاةِ فَهَلَنْتُمْ مُنْتَهُونَ. Shaytan only wants to excite enmity and hatred between you with intoxicants and gambling, and hinder you from the remembrance of Allah and from as-salah. So will you then not abstain? So he's giving the justification here, that intoxicants and gambling, these are the things which will hinder you from the remembrance of Allah and from shaitan, and they will excite enmity and hatred between you. So because of all of these mafasid, it is haram. So the question is, why not just from day one say that khamr is haram in all cases, full stop? The reason why this would not have been a good idea is because people would not take very well to this ruling, because khamr was something beloved to the people, and we know that it is addictive. So for them to be ordered to stop drinking it in totality would be difficult upon them, and they would not take well to it. This is why it had to be made haram in stages, to prevent people from apostating. Because if you just burden them with a whole host of rules and regulations from day one, then they will apostate, and there will be no Muslims left, or very few to continue this deen. This is why the Muslims at the time of the Prophet had to be dealt with in a wise and gentle manner. Because this is the crucial generation. If this generation can be established upon the deen, then what follows will be easier. Because this generation will carry the deen forward and will narrate the knowledge to the next generation and so on. We only know what we know about Islam because of the companions. They are the ones who narrated the knowledge from the Prophet. So the first generation of the Prophet was the critical generation. If you get it right with them, then everything else will be correct and easy. But if that generation apostated, then Islam would be nipped in the bud, and it would not have a chance to prosper. How can it if there are no Muslims? As for afterwards, like in this day and age of ours, if somebody becomes a Muslim, do we order him to give up alcohol in stages? No, we say alcohol is haram, and you must give it up straight away. Here we can be strict, and we don't need to do it in stages, because the issue is not critical. If people nowadays apostate from Islam, and there are very many who are doing so, this is not going to harm the deen, because the deen will continue to flourish. But this was not the case in the first generation. If people apostated then this would mean that the deen would not have a chance to flourish. This is why the first generation was the critical generation. And so this is the reason why khamr became haram in the 6th year of the Hijri, meaning to say 19 years after the Prophet was sent as a Prophet. This is how careful Allah Jalla wa Ala was with the first generation of the Muslims, not to overburden them too rapidly. Otherwise you would think, does it really take 19 years to make khamr haram? If somebody converts to Islam now, would you tell him after 19 years you can stop drinking khamr? No, there's a clear difference between Muslims now and Muslims in the first generation. First generation, critical. Now it is not too critical, because Islam has already established a foothold in the world. and will continue to flourish, no matter who apostates and who embraces. So far we have discussed that Nasr is necessary in accordance with the changing benefits of the people. And also it shows us that the Sharia has been gradually developed, stage by stage. So if we take a look at the Salah, when did this become obligatory? There's a difference of opinion. Some say 5 years before the Hijrah, some say 3 years, some say 1 year. So the earliest it would have become obligatory would be 8 years after the first revelation to the Prophet. As for the Zakah, it became obligatory in the second year of the Hijri. And some ulama have said that it was wajib during the Makkah period, but during the Medina period in the second year, the details of the Zakah were made plain. The type of wealth to give and the amount to give and so on. As for the Sawm, it was made obligatory in the second year of the Hijri, that is 15 years after the first revelation. And as for the Hajj, it was made obligatory according to the correct opinion in the 9th year. And that's just 1 year before the Prophet ﷺ died. So you can see that these acts of worship were not burdened on the Muslims all in one go. Otherwise Allah Jalla wa Ala could have made all of this obligatory in the cave of Hira, when Jibreel came down and told him to read. And along with telling him to read, he could have also told him, you have to perform your 5 times prayer every single day, you have to give zakah every lunar year, you have to perform the Sawm every Ramadan, and perform the Hajj and Umrah at least once in your life. You are not allowed to gamble, drink alcohol, fornicate, eat pig, eat dead meat, drink flowing blood. And if you disobey any of these rules, you will rot in hellfire. Enjoy your newfound religion. But the wisdom of Allah Jalla wa Ala did not dictate this. Rather, it has to be done tactfully, because you cannot afford this first generation apostating. Because if they apostate, there would be no Islam left. So from this, it becomes known the wisdom of Allah Jalla wa Ala in abrogating certain rulings and slowly but surely developing the Sharia until finally it was perfected. And he revealed the ayah, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي. Today I have perfected your deen for you and completed my favor upon you. And also from the wisdom of al-Nasr is to test the Muslims, are you ready to accept changes in the laws? Because some people may not take too well to changes. So when the Qibla was changed from Baytul Maqdis to the Masjid al-Haram, some people did not accept this, and Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Qur'an, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا الْقِبْلَةَ الَّتِي كُنْتَ عَلَيْهَا إِلَّا لِنَعْلَمَ مَنْ يَتَّبِعُ الرَّسُولَ مِمَّنْ يَنْقَلِبُ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ وَإِنْ كَانَتْ لَكَبِيرَةً إِلَّا عَلَى الَّذِينَ هَدَى اللَّهِ. And we did not change the Qibla, except that we can know who will follow the Messenger from those who will apostate, meaning turn on their heels. And this change is heavy, except on those whom Allah guides. So we found that some Muslims accepted the change and some Muslims did not accept the change. Somebody might ask here, but is it not true that Allah knows who will accept the change and who will not, who will be grateful and who will be ungrateful? We say, yes, he knew this from before. However, this knowledge of his was before the event took place. And punishment and reward is not linked to his prior knowledge. Rather, when it comes to punishment and reward, this can only be justified after the slave performs the action. So if Allah knows that a person is going to be thankful, then Allah Jalla wa Ala will not reward him for his gratefulness until after he shows that he is grateful, meaning until after he performs the action. And likewise with the punishment, Allah knows who is not grateful. But Allah Jalla wa Ala will not punish him until after he shows his ingratitude. And fourthly, from the wisdom of al-Nasr, is that if the Nasr is making life easier, it is to test who will be thankful. And if the Nasr is making life harder, then it is to test who will be patient. So when it comes to Al-Khamr, this is making life harder, so you have to be patient. When it comes to Al-Musabara, this is making life easier, so you have to be thankful. When it comes to As-Sawm, in the beginning they had a choice to fast or not to fast. If they were not going to fast, they feed poor people instead. But then fasting was made obligatory, so this is making life harder. So this is to test who will be patient. And also in the Siyam, we have a lightening of the load, in that your Siyam would start from Tulu' al-Fajr, whereas before, it would start from whenever a person went to sleep, or after Salat al-Isha. So again, this is a lightening of the load, and you have to be thankful for this. So life is a test, and so is al-Nasr, and it tests whether you are following your Huda or Hawa. Huda is guidance and Hawa is your desires. So you would follow the law of Allah whenever it suits your desires, and whenever it doesn't, you will not follow His laws. And this is the way of the kuffar. And Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَلَوِ اتَّبَعَ الْحَقُّ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ لَفَسَدَتِ السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ وَمَنْ فِيهِنْ بَلْ أَتَيْنَاهُمْ بِذِكْرِهِمْ فَهُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِهِمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. And if the truth was to follow their desires, the heavens and the earth and everything which is in between them would become corrupted. Rather, we have brought them their reminder, but they have turned away from their reminder. So we find that it is your desires which have to follow the truth, not the truth following your desires. And this is a fundamental difference between the Muslim and the kafir. The kafir follows his desires, the Muslim follows the truth, which is the guidance from Allah Jalla wa Ala.
Okay, before ending off this chapter, let us give some differences between naskh and takhsis. Difference number one, takhsis makes a naskh of some items of the generality, whereas naskh abrogates the whole ruling, wholesale. Number two, the abrogating evidence must necessarily come afterwards, meaning after the abrogated evidence, whereas in a takhsis this is not necessarily the case, because the mukhassis can come before the am. Number three, in a naskh you are actually removing a ruling after it has been established. But with a takhsis, those items which are removed from the generality did not even take the ruling of the generality in the first place. Ponder over this difference. So for example, fruits and vegetables were never in the generality of the zakah to begin with. Difference number four. Naskh necessarily can only be made using a text, either from the Quran or from the Sunnah, nothing else. Whereas in a takhsis, it is possible to make a takhsis using the aql and the his, as mentioned before, although we did say that according to the correct opinion, the aql and his do not make a takhsis. So this fourth difference is questionable. Difference number five, you can have a takhsis in the akhbar, in the declarative sentences, whereas, as we mentioned before, you can never have a naskh in a news item or a khabar. And difference number six, naskh can happen between the shara'i'. The sharia of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam can abrogate certain rulings of the sharia of Musa alayhi salam. Whereas this is not the case with takhsis. Takhsis does not happen inter shara'i', meaning in between the shara'i', but it can happen within a particular sharia. Okay, let us take a few review questions. Question number one, a naskh, abrogation, is possible and valid both through the intellect and through the text. Provide evidence for both, meaning give a rationality and also give a textual evidence that naskh can happen. Question number two, give the two conditions for a naskh to be valid. Question number three, with regards to the wording and ruling being abrogated, there are three possibilities. Mention them with examples.